Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Queer Careers video podcast, where we put a spotlight on LGBTQIA plus talent and inspire others to reach their career and development goals. Thank you for watching or listening. I am Marie-Charlotte Coury, Development Chair for the Pride Inclusion Business Group. It's an employee resource at Expedia. My pronouns are she, her. I am a white woman with green eyes and brown hair. I wear big aviator-shaped glasses, and today I have a navy blue sweater and a blue jacket. At the time we are recording this episode, we're celebrating Women Month. And there are so many amazing stories of powerful women being featured every day through the company. So I'm very happy to be talking today with Adrianna Narvaiz, program specialist, with who I have the pleasure to collaborate with almost daily. We both have a background with rainbow color shades, and in one of the corners sits the Queer Career logo, and on the other, there is a little cozy workstation with some rainbow colored elements. So that's gonna be the most I'm gonna be talking. Now, Adrianna, if please you can introduce yourself so that we get to know you better.
Yeah, my name is Adrianna Narvaiz. I go by she, her, and ella. I am a queer Latina woman who has been working with Expedia since February of 2020, so about 3 years now. And I'm currently in a position where I get to work on data, which has been a big change from where I was hired. I was hired in the call center program. Or well, in the call centers, taking phone calls from customers.
So you already went into the first question, which would be, describe your role for us to understand it better. And if you can tell us a little bit more about how you organize your week in this role.
Definitely. So in our department, in my role, we do a lot of ad hoc or on the fly reporting, as well as providing support for different company projects. You know, one of them being around career development, it's our passports project. Our weeks are currently split into sprints where we plan a week ahead. We try to organize anything that may have been pushed back from something that we couldn't get to. Really, we spend like about maybe an hour or two on Fridays to organize our week ahead. It's a lot of just reassessing priorities and deadlines. A lot of time management.
So to make it 100% clear, for who is not familiar with agile priorities and organization everything, so you have to reorganize constantly because you're the one responsible for solving or improving stuff on several programs from the company. Yes. According to some issues that are open daily, and you constantly have to see like which one has to be prioritized first and just determine the order, right?
Yeah, we have to determine the order partially based on like who's requesting the information and like also how complicated is the ask. Sometimes it's a very quick, you know I can do this in 5 minutes. And so I can knock that out really quickly. But also sometimes it means part of scoping this out is recognizing that I'm gonna have to learn a few things to get this done. And so being able to assess that information and then relay that to our stakeholders, you know, hey, we can get this done for you. Here's a rough estimate of the time frame for how long that'll take. The agile planning is definitely something I've still getting used to.
And you have to embrace the learning mindset, like you're constantly learning new stuff, right?
Yeah, all the time.
Yeah, amazing. So we're gonna go to the second question, that is, what do you know now you wish you would have known before starting in this position or in your career in general?
I think I wish I would have known that the things that I did in high school, like on the side and like as an early college student, to give a time frame, that was around 2007, you know, from editing and like creating HTML and CSS backgrounds, you know, in the era of like MySpace and Tumblr, that would actually come into play at my work. I never thought that my experiences there doing something that I considered play on the side would become part of my daily work. And it would influence how my work is presented. And so I think I wish, yeah, if I could have known anything before coming into this career, is that all of the things that I did on the side and things that I considered like just for me, could be viewed as professional and I could get paid to do it.
No, it's actually like kind of something that you were passionate about and you were able to apply it to kind of completely transition, because going from the call center to a data kind of technical skilled position is definitely a big transition.
Yeah, that I will say, I think one of the big things that also really helps that I didn't know would help is because in the role that I was in on the phone, we would take a lot of escalations. I was part of the resolutions team, and we were specifically, you know, whenever somebody screamed for a manager, I was the manager that you would get on the phone. And having those de-escalation skills, being able to stay stable and aware of my own emotional state while I was on the phone with somebody, being able to talk down or talk up expectations and just being able to explain things, that has fully transitioned over into my work now, because instead of talking with customers, now I'm talking, my customers are now my stakeholders. And so it's about learning how to like bridge those any gaps in communication. And a lot of the work that I did on the call center still applies. It's just applied in a different way.
Yeah, we can definitely give the example when I don't understand something technical, mm-hmm. and you have to explain to me, and you definitely do that amazingly, like to give me all the elements to be able to understand what are your requirements to translate something that is not technical from my perspective, that has to be translated into something technical from your perspective and just get to a resolution, definitely. And you do that very well.
Thank you.
You're welcome. We can get to the other question. So what helped you get into this particular job that we kind of brushed over? And what helps you be successful in it?
I will say part of it, you know, to recognize my own achievements, definitely has to do with like my tenacity and my insatiable like curiosity. I love to learn. I learn for the sake of learning. It's something that I've always enjoyed. And also to be very realistic and to recognize really how lucky I am to be able to make the kinds of transition that I'm making at here in the office. It comes from like my leadership. I was able to identify, I like this and I would like to do more things related to this, and this being data analytics. And my supervisors were amenable to that. And so they did their best to give me opportunities to be able to pull data and clean data and showcase it and tell a story through that visualization. And so, you know, it's a good mix of like luck, because, you know, I think having a supportive supervisor cannot be underestimated, you know, the skill of networking, introducing yourself to different people, trying to take what you can from that as far as like, you know, making those connections, networking. And then just, you know, the other 40, 50% of it, I would say, is probably just applying your own work ethic. That's something that I think is very hard to teach, is work ethic. You can teach a skill to just about anybody, but having your own ethics, morals, and goals, and the ability to follow through with that, I think is a much more difficult hill to climb if those aren't already well established. And it's something that's like, it's a daily practice. It's something that you do constantly. Like I'm constantly trying to get better at my time management, and being able to, you know, just get things into a place where I can speak with more confidence in them. And I think another part is just giving yourself grace, being kind to yourself and recognizing that when you make a mistake, it's part of learning. And so that definitely helped me be successful here.
Oh, it seems like you have a high bar for yourself and you keep yourself at a high level of accountability. Mm-hmm. Like you have a very good plan of what you expect from yourself, and you just put your milestones in place. And definitely what you said about the leadership, like you can have a very strong plan, but if at some point nobody helps you create opportunities, because trying to create for ourselves is amazing, but sometimes it doesn't necessarily depend on yourself. And you have to have the help of somebody else, a sponsor, a leader, somebody who trusts and just helps you getting to the next step, is definitely being lucky to have a leader who listens to you and just provides you with opportunities to grow in something you like. That's amazing. And it ties really nicely with the next question, which is, what are the resources that help you evolve in your career? So the queer community, IBGs, LGBT plus job boards, networks, books, podcasts, e-learning, mentoring people. And I know you already said that you're a super curious person, so I guess you're going to have a lot of resources that you can share with us to help us do the same.
Yeah, I will definitely try. So something that I've recently heard a few things that I've learned. So one of the things that has been kind of a mantra since I first heard it, and this was years ago, I don't remember who said it, but the saying is that all you have to do is show up. You don't have to give 110%. You don't have to push yourself to burden and to break. Just show up. The rest will fall into place, but show up every day. And so I start with showing up. I also have had an amazing network of, because I'm based in Austin, Texas, and I'm from San Antonio, Texas, women of color and other women of color have always been my strongest supporters. They've been my educators. They have been my mentors. And they, you know, they'll engage with my interests even when they don't understand the scope that I'm working in. And so I will say, like, that community of having different Latina and Black women support and offering, you know, their wisdom and their education, things that they've learned throughout their careers, that has definitely helped me evolve in here. Since joining Expedia, networking with the IBGs and communicating with the IBGs, having this recognition that, you know, we're all in this together. We're all, everybody's hoping for, you know, to have like the same rights recognized and acknowledged and to be able to be evaluated based on, you know, our skills rather than just the identities that we hold. And so with that, like, an easy resource, and it's not one that anybody can just go Google, is, but it's connecting with your community, wherever your community may be. And if you don't have a community to connect to, it's part of becoming one, you know, creating your own, making the space, and identifying, like, you know, who the safe space is for. If we're in an IBG where, we'll say BEAM, for instance, you know, BEAM is a safe space for Black expedients, you know, in the company. And so, you know, the tolerance for somebody who may have like an ignorant or racist attitude or behavior, it's not quite going to be tolerated there. And which isn't to say that it's going to be tolerated in other places, but like that is a safe space for Black expedients. And so the onus of ensuring that safe space is there for them, it's up to allies and other people to ensure that we're having those hard conversations where we bring somebody in, we call them in, and, you know, we hold them accountable and we have them recognize how their rhetoric or their ideas may be culturally destructive. And, you know, being part of and showing up to creating the culture that I want to see in the world is a part of it. And listening to people from those margins has been one of my greatest teachers. And so, you know, as far as like social media goes, I'm on like all sorts of different kinds of TikToks and different sides of TikTok. And it exposes me to people who aren't necessarily from, you know, my background, and being able to see them be their authentic selves and live their, you know, whatever their truth is. One of my favorite accounts that I watch is like a girl who has, she's Muslim, and she mostly talks about her cat. And it's about her cat, like being a Muslim cat and, you know, praying, and that's haram. And it's being able to see her humor. And I have not had a whole bunch of like Muslim friends in my own community, which isn't to say that they don't exist. It's just they haven't been around the circles that I've been around. So being able to see that connection, and, you know, sometimes we educate ourselves through reading, and reading only goes so far. It's a lot of it. You kind of have to make the effort to make that human connection. And as you grow that, like the resources that come to you from that community is just, they're infinite, really. I feel like I rattled a little bit there, but yeah.
No, I love what you said, and I love that you gave details, because what I'm getting is constants from the first thing that you said, like showing up. Even if you're not feeling 100%, you show up, and you show up a little bit like every day, and that's how you create the big career steps for your evolution and your growth and your development. And the second thing that I'm getting is community. Mm-hmm. Like, we can't focus on creating the right skills, or maybe we can, but it's not going to be useful if we're not being recognized, because there are some blockers that are due to our identities. And intersectional identities are amazing to have a different perspective also, and to evolve. And just, you're saying like learning takes you only so far, but really listening to people's from other identities is going to broaden your scope and just take off your blind spots. Yeah. In some way, if I'm listening correctly. And we can be allies, and we can support each other, and we can make those skills that we're learning for our career valuable in all the spaces, because we're kind of connecting the safe spaces together. Like you said, BEAM, for example, for Black expedients, and we have LEAD for Latinos, and we have mm-hmm. Pride for the LGBTQ community. If we connect those spaces, we create greater spaces where your talent and the talent of other people with intersectional identities will be accepted.
Yeah.
And just putting a spotlight on it. And we know we have a lot of amazing talent in those communities. So I really like it. It's very personal approach. And I think what you said is completely, it's super important. Like, you can work a lot on your talent, but if you have no safe space that will recognize it, it's kind of, you know, it's only going to be for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So the next question, and this is a difficult conversation that we're having kind of in a positive way, but it ties really good with the other question that is, could you share the biggest learning you had from an obstacle or a failure? So you already said that for you, there is no failure because every single stuff that you don't know or mistake that you do, it's an opportunity for learning.
Mm-hmm. It is. And I think the biggest obstacle has been committing to that in my everyday, committing to the belief that failures are not, they're not failures. They're not the end. They're not where things stop. It's an opportunity to learn, you know, what did I learn that I didn't know before I failed at this? That's the biggest learning has been to apply that, you know, okay, I learned something from this. Next time I can try it in this way. Or we can make these opportunities to go farther than where we went before. Failure, we're human. Failure is expected. And getting to fully believe that in my everyday, just, you know, both in and out of work, the hardest part has been accepting that and being okay with it, allowing myself that grace to fail. Being kind to myself when I fail, letting myself know, you know, nobody's gonna see, you know, or if something that I do at work is just, you know, it has an error in it and somebody points out that error, it's not, Adrianna, you did a bad job. It's, hey, can you get this fixed? And I can get it fixed. We can fix it. Things that fail and break at work, they're fixable. And things may not always be fixable outside of work, but, you know, we can find a way to make ourselves okay with it and to make ourselves grow from that. And so the biggest obstacle has just been applying it both out inside of work and out.
No, definitely. It's something that we have to be, yeah, more graceful to ourselves, because sometimes we apply, I don't know why, but we tend to apply mostly a higher bar to ourselves than the one we would apply to the person in front of us. And I don't know why. So it's a good thing that we definitely have to remind ourselves. Thank you for saying that.
Yeah.
And the next question is, how has your identity influenced your career and vice versa?
I would say my identity has influenced my career. Honestly, I was a little bit nervous. I didn't see, like, in my department, where when I came into the department, I didn't see women in that department. Historically, before I got to the department, no other woman had been in that role. And so that's one big one. I think I historically am also the only queer person that has stepped into this role. And, you know, I'm not the only Latina person, but it's something that I noticed. Thankfully for my management, amazing. But I noticed that there was a shift and an adjustment that needed to happen to have a woman in that role and to have somebody who's Latina in that role, because there's a lot of, we all know about, like, systemic racism and systemic homophobia and things like that. And so those things don't just live in the systems, because, you know, the society has those problems too. They also carry in, you know, in ourselves. We have to be the ones that, you know, challenge that in person, interpersonally. And so there was an adjustment period where, you know, some of my coworkers needed to evaluate the way in which they spoke to me and the way in which they expressed their feelings, because sometimes it's like, well, I don't know if you recognize that this is probably a bit harsh, but have you noticed that you tend to take out your anger on me only, but not the men in our group? And so sometimes it means, you know, taking the space to have those conversations. And so like, I'm being cognizant of that and being able to navigate this space. I feel very lucky that we're as open to having these kinds of conversations at Expedia. This is the first company that has ever been as supportive as this company is for us to have these conversations where we can bring somebody in with kindness, where it's not, the default isn't, oh, let's all run to HR and get this person, you know, out of the company. The hope is that people learn from their mistakes and they grow from them. And so that, in as far as like my identity goes, I'm also neurodivergent. I have trauma, I have PTSD. It's something that I share with my managers. And with that, like the brain chemistry, the chemistry of my brain does not produce, you know, the chemicals that I need. And so I have medication, and there are certain things that like need to be spelled out in a specific way for me to be able to kind of work with that. And it's also, it's part of why I'm so intentional about sharing the whys if I'm explaining something, especially when it's a no. If there's a no that, you know, we're not going to do this, I want to explain the limitations of why that no is happening. And so that impacts my career in the fact that like some people find direct communication to be aggressive or bossy or just, you know, usually negative connotation. And it's not intended for me to be a brute. I'm just really just trying to make sure that I have a clear understanding so that we can continue to move forward. And so my career has also influenced my identity because this has helped me, that Expedia allowing us to be our authentic selves has helped me embrace who I am more. It's not that I need permission and not that we need permission to be ourselves, but in some way it's almost like, yeah, it's okay. You can be exactly who you are and you can show up here and you're going to be treated with respect and dignity. And that is so new to me, but it's also so impactful and I adore it. And I haven't had that from career before. It's a beautiful thing. It's been able to allow me to lean into parts of myself that I had either minimized or just not been able to explore because, you know, life gets busy.
No, it's super interesting what you're saying, because it seems like kind of a two-way learning process. So being able to, by the way, it's very brave because most of us, I think, tend to avoid difficult conversations. So we don't give the opportunity to a person in front of us to be aware that maybe they're doing something that is hurtful, even if not purposefully, mm-hmm. but we're not giving the opportunity to correct this behavior if we don't talk and have this conversation, as you said, like in a safe way, taking this person aside and just saying, hey, I just wanted to share with you that I'm this and that, and I need this and that to be like fully myself and be comfortable with the conversation that we need to have on a day-to-day basis, and just give the opportunity for the person to modify their behavior. So I think it's very brave, and I hope like all of the people would do that, because I'm a person, I crave feedback personally, because I feel I must make a ton of mistakes. And if people don't call me out on them, I'm never going to be able to improve.
Yeah.
So I think
you don't know what you don't know.
Amazing. Yeah, exactly. So I think it's amazing that you take the step. And also when you're saying like, you also took a lot of feedback for you and what your identity brings to the table in a very positive way, but also some stuff that could be hurtful for other people. Like in the way you express, the way you have to give like all those directions and everything. I'm a big direct communication person, yeah. So I understand you. But yeah, some people may have said to me, like, some at some point, like, you come across as too aggressive or maybe too direct, and it's absolutely not my intention. So I'm very grateful for those people to call me out, because I can modify my way of communicating so that I can say what I have to say and be assertive, but just be mindful of what they need for me to be communicating and come across in the right way. So yeah, it's super interesting. Thank you for sharing.
Yeah.
And we're unfortunately getting to the last question. So what percentage would you attribute to luck, and which would you say is merit and effort related?
I thought about this one a lot since we first like met to talk about this. And I still don't have a definite percentage. I can say at least 30% luck, if not more. Because I think, you know, I'm lucky to have had a computer when I was very, very young. I'm lucky to have had internet when I was young. I was lucky to be able to go to decent education. You know, I didn't finish college, but I was able to attend college for a short time. I had access to a lot of things that I know some people my age didn't have access to at a young age. And so I know that those gave me boosts. I'm lucky to be a light-skinned Latina. You know, while I'm brown, I'm not, I don't face like the discrimination that dark-skinned people do. I'm lucky to be, for the most part, hetero-passing. I'm bisexual, and most people see me in my partner, and my partner is a queer trans person, and they think that we're either just friends, or it's not until like they see us, I guess, romantically, that they're like, oh, lesbians. And so like there's a lot of luck in different ways, just getting access to places and you know, to be recognized and valued in those ways, and that's just like kind of a societal luck of the draw. And then there's the other aspect towards like, I also know that I worked very hard to get into the position that I'm in. I've done so many learnings. I'm constantly learning. It's something that I worked a lot of overtime. I signed up for every project that I could get my hands on. And, you know, I would stay super late. And so, you know, a good mix. I almost want to say 50-50 luck and merit, but maybe it is. It's something that, I guess it depends on how you look at it. I want to acknowledge, though, like all of the privileges that I've had, and that those did help me get to where I am, without discounting all of the work that I put in to bring myself here as well. And so, between 30% and 50% of luck, depending on how I'm feeling.
It's a tough question. I mean, you're not the first person saying it has been very difficult to answer to this question. I think in one episode it was just left unanswered. because it can also depend on, you know, as you said, depending on the day, on what you're feeling, depending on the state like of your career, like if it's now or if it's at the beginning, maybe it can evolve. So I think you gave a pretty fair answer for this percentage question. And yeah, thank you so much for everything that you disclosed in this interview. I really enjoyed it. You made me learn so many things. So I'm very grateful. Do you want to say something before we say goodbye?
I think my only words of wisdom that I have is really just to remember to be kind to yourself. I think if we looked at ourselves with kinder eyes, we would probably extend that to the world a little bit more often. And I know it can be hard, especially for somebody who grows up in a queerphobic society, you know, where when I was growing up, they had the It Gets Better campaign. And as a teenager, I was like, well, it doesn't get better. You just get better at handling it. And I'm hopeful for the day that it does continue to get better. And I think hope is a hope is a skill. Hope is
it's something you have to work on. Hope.
You have to work on hope, and just remember to be kind to yourself while you're doing that. And I think that'll take you a little bit farther. It'll get you to the next level.
It's a beautiful way to end the interview. And definitely it's going to be serving me well when I look at the news right now.
Yeah.
Definitely, I'm going to exercise on hope. And thank you so much, Adrianna. It was amazing having you. And just stay tuned for the next episode.
Definitely. Thank you so much for giving me the time. I appreciate it.
Bye. Take care.
Bye.